Welcome to this second podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination relating to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to brain architecture and development. We will talk about how the brain develops, the effect of early experiences and stress, how brain architecture regulates biological systems responsible for complex human behaviors, and how social interactions help guide development of the brain. To begin, let's discuss how early positive and negative experiences influence the creation of our brain architecture. Our brains are built over time, starting before birth and continuing through infancy, childhood, adolescence, and young adulthood. Brain architecture and development abilities are built from the bottom up. Simple brain circuits must be successfully created in order to provide a strong base or scaffold for the more advanced circuits and skills that develop later on. Dr. Judy Cameron is a professor of physiology and pharmacology at the University of Pittsburgh. Here she discusses the role of early experiences and the development of a child's brain.
What happens in the first few years of life is a number of connections are made. Many, many connections. This is a period where neurons are sending out dendrites and they're connecting to many other neurons. You have more connections in early life than you'll have at any other time in your life. Now, that doesn't mean you're smarter when you're 2 years old than you're going to be later on. You have a lot of connections. But we're going to pare down those connections so that only the most important, most used connections stay. And that's where experience matters enormously. We can ask, of all these connections, which connections stay and which connections are pared away? And the answer is, the ones that get used the most are going to stay. Brain architecture and skills are built in a bottom-up sequence so that you provide a very good foundation before other brain processes develop. Neural circuits that process basic information are wired earlier than those that process more complex information. Higher circuits build on the lower circuits. Adaptation at higher skill levels is more difficult if the lower circuits are not wired properly. Advanced skills build on basic skills in all aspects of development. So you start with a good foundation and build from there. If the foundation is not strong, rest of the structure is not going to be able to be formed as well.
So our brains and skills are slowly built over time, and as different brain areas develop, different functions come online, and as the brain matures, these skills become more sophisticated. In this sense, we develop skills that are age-appropriate, or skills that we need to survive and develop during the early stages of life. Dr. Pat Levitt is the chair of the Department of Cell and Neurobiology at the Keck School of Medicine. Here he describes how our skills develop in early childhood.
We want these systems to develop very early on. Why? Because we need to be able to do what Steve just showed, stick your tongue out. So your visual, auditory, somatosensory, tactile systems need to develop extraordinarily early in order to be able to interact with your environment. In the human, the language system develops over a much longer time period. And of course, you've already seen this already, what we call higher cognitive functions, and you can put this into reward systems as well. It has a very long and extended period of development.
Early experiences also leave lasting signatures on our genes. Dr. Cameron explains.
So I'm going to spend a few minutes introducing the concept of how early experience alters gene expression. So we already talked about how it altered circuits. Remember, neurons reach out and connect to other neurons, and then the circuits that get used stay. But that's not the only thing that experience does. Experience changes gene expression inside the brain cells. And we're going to talk about how that happens. So, the working unit in the brain is the brain cell, and we call that a neuron. Remember, you'll see here that it has dendrites. It's collecting information from other brain cells, and then it's sending signals down its axon to transmit the information. Now, if we look inside a single cell, inside a single neuron, we have chromosomes. That's what's passed from the mother and the father. Every cell has a set of chromosomes, and that's where the genes are. So you have DNA, and you have a number of genes on the DNA. And what we see is that experience can influence which of these genes are being bred, which are really being used by a cell. So external experience is going to change gene regulatory proteins, and those are going to give you an epigenetic signature. They're going to turn genes off and turn genes on.
Healthy brain architecture, therefore, is built by the interaction of our genes and the environment over time. Certain parts of the brain are particularly important in regulating our emotions and how we perceive and interact with the outside world. These are the areas of the brain that include our reward circuitry, which involves the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is located just behind the forehead and is in charge of abstract thinking, thought analysis, regulating behavior, and governing social control. Dr. Judy Cameron explains the importance of the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex during early brain development.
Well, it turns out that at 1 week of age, processes are going on in the brain and neural circuits are forming that are different than the circuits that are forming at 1 month of age. And the circuits that are undergoing plastic changes are the circuits that are going to be most affected by an adverse early experience. And the amygdala is a structure that plays a very important role in social interaction, governing social circuits. Remember back to my recipe example. You have lots of cookbooks in your kitchen, but you choose to cook something in particular. So think of the cookbooks as genes. You have them there. But the ones that you're reading the information from, that you're paying attention to, are the ones you choose to make. So genes that are expressed and are making proteins are the genes that that cell is using to tell what to do. All 200 of those genes in the amygdala are changed if you experienced adversity at 1 week of life as a monkey. So all the genes that were expressed at a high level are now expressed at a low level. The genes that were expressed at a low level are expressed at a high level. This is not all the genes in the amygdala. There are many more genes. These are the 200 that are very influenced by that experience. And that pattern of gene expression stays with the animal well into development, into adulthood. So you have an effect by experiences on what circuits are formed and what circuits are pruned. You also have a very strong effect on what genes are expressed and what genes are not expressed.
The development of healthy brain architecture, therefore, is particularly sensitive to adverse childhood experiences like toxic stress, abuse, neglect, and poor caregiving. In fact, the interaction between infant and caregiver is critical. Here, Pat Levitt describes this as a game of serve and return.
The sort of serve and return interactions, the expectation that I do something and you're going to do something back. And so, you know, it takes all these forms. Familiarity is important. It happens with adults, it happens with primary caregivers, it happens with parents, it happens with peers and siblings, all of which are important. And all of these interactions affect everything from the chemicals in the brain to physical structures and connections therein. So this serve and return system in some ways is involved in setting our, what we heard about, what Matt talked about before, but setting our homeostatic set point, particularly as it relates to our ability to manage stressors and challenges that come at us on a daily basis. And so in a simplistic way, these early positive experiences make this very positive face, you know, much larger. And of course, creating a homeostatic set point that perhaps may allow us to be able to respond in appropriate ways within a particular window. And negative experiences creating a different homeostatic set point, which then gets read out in all the kinds of behaviors that we heard about this morning, and even what Steve talked about today, that in some ways it's about setting the expectations that development and the development of the brain by its very nature requires experience to continue its development. And so what is it doing? It's reading this information, it's interpreting it, and then it's saying, oh, this is what I'm going to be encountering for the rest of my life. So let me get my system wired up in a way where I'm going to be able to deal with this.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Simple brain circuits must be successfully created in order to provide a strong base or scaffold for the more advanced circuits and skills that develop later on. As different brain areas develop, different functions come online, and as the brain matures, these skills become more sophisticated. Both positive and negative early experiences leave lasting signatures on our genes. Certain parts of the brain are particularly important in regulating our emotions and how we perceive and interact with the outside world. These are the areas of the brain that include our reward circuitry, which includes the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the prefrontal cortex. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMeds competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how will you integrate and apply this new knowledge on brain development? 2. How could you integrate this new knowledge on brain development when obtaining the personal history and identifying important relationships of a patient with an addiction? Can this be done in a safe and non-judgmental way? 3. How do you think children who have been subjected to early toxic stress might present? How would you assist or advocate for children who are subjected to early toxic stress? 4. In a family practice setting, can you think of proactive initiatives to increase awareness about healthy brain development and to support maternal, family, and child health? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on brain architecture and development. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this page, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.